Okay. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Optical Networks for the Cloud session. My name is Mania Gobadi. I'm a postdoc researcher at MSR. And I'm going to just give you a very brief overview of why we created this session and, you know, just mention a couple of projects. And then we have three exciting talks from experts in optics. Okay, I'm going to start with the fact that optics are the workhorses of the cloud networking. Optical links are ubiquitous in entire wide area network or long-haul links and data centers. Optics are actually poised to play an even bigger role in the next generation networks with the low latency and high bandwidth requirements that is posed by, you know, machine learning workloads and big data analytics. Using these traditional electrical switches and the traditional networks is not going to be scaling. So we think that a lot can be achieved by introducing collaboration between industry and academia. And that's why we created this session at Faculty Summit. We invited researchers from academia, and we have talks from Microsoft products team as well. And our idea is that we hope that this session is going to create new ideas and introduce create new conversations in both systems and optics research areas. Just like there's a very interesting fusion actually between optics and systems research. And Microsoft is actually positioned pretty uniquely in this area. We own and we operate these optical networks. So we have this opportunity to learn from these networks. We can actually move the industry by the massive scale that Microsoft has. So as a result, we're building and monitoring all of these optical links that we have at Microsoft. One of the projects that we have is that we're monitoring all of our long-haul links, all amplifier nodes, and all digital nodes in the wide area network. And one of the results that came out of this was, we just presented it at OFC conference this year, is to use banded variable links in the wide area network. We have another ongoing exciting project on introducing programmability into the physical layer. Just take it from the IP layer, put it in the physical layer. And we call this optical software defined network. But this is just the wide area network. In the data center, we've been monitoring over 100 production data centers, all of the optical links there. And we're learning new things about them. We're creating proposals for cheap transponders and smart routing in the data center. But we take these measurements and then we learn from them and we explore new optical designs into the data centers as well. We have two collaborative projects with academia. One is designing a free space optical data center interconnect using a chip that is ubiquitous in projection technology. We're going to present this in upcoming SITCOM conference. There's another exciting project that is building high radix nanosecond switching infrastructure to build a flat data center topology. We presented the earlier results at OFC, and the project's actually ongoing. But so none of this session is not about either of these projects. What we're here is to listen and to initiate new conversations. And with that, I'm going to give the podium to Paolo to introduce our speakers.
Okay, thanks, Monia. Hi, everyone. So my name is Paolo. I'm a researcher in Microsoft Research Cambridge. So it's my great pleasure and honor to introduce Jeff Cox. So Jeff leads the optical network, optical engineering and network test team here in Azure. And he oversees the development of the end-to-end network infrastructure that powers Microsoft online and cloud services. So Jeff has a huge experience in industry. Before joining Microsoft, he has worked in several companies, including Juniper Networks, BT, Level 3, and he also founded a startup along the way. So we thought it was really a great opportunity for us to have Jeff here and to open the session with him, as he can provide us with an overview of the current state of optics in industry, and perhaps most importantly, the trends that he sees for the next 5 to 10 years. So, Jeff, over to you.
Thank you, Paolo. Get me wired up here. All right. All right. Thank you, Paolo. And thank you, everybody, for attending the session. What I want to do today is kind of go through Microsoft's optical infrastructure. We'll kind of start with an overview of the overall infrastructure, So be familiar with the terminology that I'll repeatedly use throughout the presentation. And we'll talk about all the various optical componentry that exists today and what we think the next step or the next generation of that's going to be in the next few years. I've broken it out into that set of equipment and optics that lives inside of the data center or maybe in a campus environment. Stuff that lives at what we call the regional level. A region to us is basically a metropolitan area inside of our network where we might have multiple data centers scattered around a metro tied together. And then interconnecting those regions, we have long haul and submarine optical technologies to provide bandwidth, large scale bandwidth between the data centers. So the talk's broken into these three different pieces. The little taglines there, shades of gray. The term gray optics is a term that isn't ubiquitously used in the industry, but to us it basically means those singular point-to-point links where there's only a pluggable optic, if you will, on either end of it and just a piece of glass between it. Typically these are used inside the data centers or maybe limited use at a regional level, but there isn't any external DWDM equipment or amplifiers or anything like that. Now that's not to say that that link might not have some sort of DWDM technology embedded in the module itself, but we call all of those links and group them together and call them gray. Yes?
Can you tell me what DWDM is?
DWDM, dense wave division multiplexing. Yeah, so WDM is the more general case of it, or wave division multiplexing. The idea is I take multiple colors of light and I shove them on a fiber in order to increase the capacity of the fiber. It's a very common technique, certainly when you go over larger distances and you want to share a fiber asset with more and more capacity. And indeed, the gray links in general don't use a great deal of DWDM. In fact, they may not have WDM in them at all. Some do, some don't. Whereas the other technologies, the regional and the long haul, certainly do. And in fact, the long haul and the submarine are typically on the cutting edge of cramming as much capacity as you can on a very expensive fiber resource, which may run around a country or may indeed even go under the ocean. These are the three areas. We'll start off with the DC and the campus. So gray, again, is that set of optics we use that don't require external DWDM systems. And you'll hear me use the term colored to mean those types of optics that have external DWDM systems associated with them. All right, so this is a general overview of what a data center looks like to us, a very high-level design. Starting at the very lowest layer here, we have the servers. The servers are attached to a tier zero switch or a TOR. Most people call these things. The TORs are attached to tier one switches. We build up a hierarchy. They go up to a set of tier two switches, which live in the IDF, or intermediate distribution frame, which is a fancy word for a wiring closet with a bunch of switches in it. And then when it leaves this facility and enters the metropolitan region, we will use some sort of WDM optical technology to connect it to a set of regional hubs, and we'll talk about that here in a second. Also, if this data center is one of potentially many on a campus environment, instead of DWDM, we may indeed use gray optics to go between that tier two switch and the tier two, or the tier three, or whatever the switch is that is above it. In terms of these switching technologies, these green ones down here basically live in a row of servers. There might be on the order of 500 to upwards of 1,000 servers and 20 or so racks of equipment. The TORs live in each rack, and these tier ones live in the middle of row for us in our design. And so this forms what we call a pod set, which is essentially a fancy word for a row of equipment in our data centers. And then we make many of those pod sets in order to build out a data center. There could be hundreds or even thousands of rows of pod sets in some of the larger data centers. And then those are uplinked into these two wiring closets. Essentially all of the lines, with the exception of the first set we'll talk about here in a second, all of the lines that interconnect all of these switching boxes are some form of optics. All right, a lot of people think of the network and they focus on the switch itself and kind of ignore that, well, all of the switches must be connected together with something, and that something is fiber and optics in almost every case. In fact, from a cost perspective, that optical part of the network, all of those links and all that fiber, about half of the cost of the network. A lot of people think of the switches as being the expensive piece. Right? They're not cheap, but the optics are on the same order of cost as the switching infrastructure in the network. Okay. Today, we're going through an evolution away from the 40 gig network technologies to the 100 gig network technologies. We call that a set of things the 100 gig ecosystem. It includes the switches and all the various optics and the links that go between it. We are just now beginning to deploy that this year by the first quarter of next calendar year to be in full swing, and pretty much everything we'll deploy will be part of this 100 gig ecosystem. And so the 100 gig ecosystem includes new sets of these Tor and Tier 1 switches, which are 32 by 100 gig pizza box looking switches. And then these Tier 2 switches are chassis boxes, roughly 13 RU high, and they have slots in them. Each line card has 3600 gig ports in it, and you might have 8 or 12 or 16 slots in them, but the 8 slot one ends up with 28800 gig ports. And then there'd be a series of those, and those IDF up to 64. We can have up to 64 at that level in the network, and that would support roughly 100,000 servers down in the data center. All of the optics that plug into this 100 gig equipment is a form factor that's called QSFP28. It's a very specific defined industry form factor, little pluggable things, about as big as your thumb, maybe a little larger than your thumb. There was quite a battle a few years back about which form factor was going to exist. There were a number of them in competition. Microsoft pushed the QSFP28 and along with a lot of other people in the industry, and eventually it has become the dominant industry standard for 100 gig pluggable optic units. It varies. In general, we talk about there being like a 3-to-1, a 3-to-1, and an 8-to-1 is sort of the generic number that we use. A lot of this depends on not all pod sets are built exactly the same. There's different server counts. There's different rack counts. There may be different numbers of pod sets in data centers depending on the physical size of the data center and all of that. And of course, it's not necessarily all populated at the same time. So generically, we say 3-to-1, 3-to-1, and 8-to-1. But it could be vary by a factor of two or more in some cases, just depending on the particular design. All right, the first set of quote optics, in this case not really a set of optics, but starting down here at the bottom, the Tor to the server link, these ones I've highlighted as red, and you'll see I'll highlight in red as we go through the slides which link I'm talking about, is actually not optics, it's a copper cable. It's a type of cable called a direct attached copper. We use it because, well, it's very cheap. It's a very, very cost-effective link technology. And between the Tor and the server and the rack is no more than a meter or two. It's a very short distance. And indeed, running these signals at this speed over this cable can only go a short distance. The maximum length of these cables is about 3 meters or 2 meters, depending on the particular technology. But it's very cost-effective. So the link between the Tor and the server is actually a copper technology. It could be optics, and in the future, when you start looking out into 2019 and 20, we'll probably start running 100 gigs to the server. So today we run 40 gigs to the server, and we're starting to roll out 50 gigs to the server. And in that case, the 50 gig server looks a little bit like this fan-out cable here. There's one connector on one end that's got 100 gigs, and this one actually shows a breakout into 425s, but there's another variation of this cable that's got 100 gig on one end and 250 gigs. Coming out of it, and that's when we go to 50 gigs, that's exactly what that cable would be. It'd have 100 gigs plugged into the Tor and 250 gig links that would plug down into the servers. It would all live inside of that rack, and those cables would be usually really short, a half a meter or a meter long, something of that nature, and that would tie the servers to the very first switch in the network. All right, so not optics at all. Now, when we get to 100 gigs to the server, the faster you run that link, the shorter the distance over a piece of copper you can actually go. So at some point, as the link speeds of the servers increase, copper will not make it more than like a few inches, and you have to start using some other technology. So we believe optics to the server is coming. In fact, we've been working with a number of suppliers in order to make that very cost effective. And in fact, even at 50 gig, we could probably cost effectively do optics to the server with some of the designs we're looking at that aren't quite here yet. But we certainly believe in the 2019-20 timeframe, by the time we go to 100 gig type servers, that we'll probably do some sort of optics to the server technology. And the very last link in the network that isn't fiber and optics will become fiber and optics.
The 50 gig is 50 gig serial, or is it still logically
225? The lane speed is 225s in this generation. There is and you'll see in a slide coming up, there's a standard proposed where it's a serial 50 gig lane. So the 50 gig, so like this cable is actually 425s, and what they do is they take two of those and bundle them together and make one 50 gig link, and if you look inside of it, there's actually 225 transmits and 225 receives at the copper level. We call those lanes. And that's because the switching chip that lives up here has 25 gig lanes coming out of it. So this cable is mated directly to the lanes on that switching chip and has the same speed as the lanes on that switching chip. The chips that are coming out in this time frame, the 1920 time frame, will have 50 gig lanes in them. All right, so we're expecting that the silicon to move up, and the SerDes and the electrical interfaces coming out of the switching chips will migrate to 50 gigs. There's two proposals, a 50 gig PAM4 proposal, which takes a 25 gigabaud signal, modulates it with four levels, and you get 50 gigabits per second. There's also a 50 gig NRZ, which simply modulates it at 50 gigabits per second or 50 gigabaud. And the industry's battling over which one of those is going to win at the moment. Matter of fact, there might be both variations in the industry. This link right here, the servers are getting faster, getting more cores, faster buses, the never-ending cycle of server silicon.
You're essentially keeping up with the evolution of servers.
Yes, something else that's happening down here is we're building NICs that have a hardware offload in them that accelerate a lot of the throughput of it. In fact, the NICs that we have today can saturate a 40 gig or a 50 gig link. But with the DMA access that's in them. So those technologies are simply requiring more and more speed down to the servers. The next set of links up between the TOR and the Tier 1 here, we use a cable that's called an AOC or an active optical cable. This cable is kind of interesting. It's actually two QSFP28 optics modules, and it already has the fiber cable run between it, and that fiber cable is permanently molded into the optic. So this is an assembly. It comes pre-assembled from the factory. We get them in different lengths, and they're very cost-effective. The actual technology in it is actually a multi-mode fiber and VCSEL lasers. So there's actually, instead of two fibers in there, there's 24 fibers in there, or 16 fibers, I think, inside that cable. And we simply order them varying lengths in order to handle the various distances needed to build out a row. But it's reach limited to less than 100 meters, so we only use them inside of the row and don't really go any further than that inside the data center. One of the huge advantages, because that all becomes comes as an assembly to us, is we don't have to clean and inspect fiber surfaces like you'll see on the upcoming modules. Every time you have an exposed fiber connector and you want to plug it in or assemble the row or the rack, you have to clean the surface and use a microscope and inspect it, and then you can plug it in. You have to do both ends of that, because any little grain of dust in there will damage that fiber surface and make a very bad connection. Not only make a bad connection, actually damage the fiber itself, and you have to replace the connector. A lot of people don't understand that just a little speck of dust, when you put it on that surface, the mating surface is just a few microns in diameter, and the pressure that you put on it, while it's only your finger pressure, by the time it gets concentrated down to that few micron dust grain, you're putting tens of thousands of PSI of pressure on a glass surface, and it simply fractures the glass. So cleaning and inspection is an inherent piece of installing these things. So this cable doesn't have that. It's already molded. There's no exposed glass fiber mating surface. So this saves us installation and maintenance time and errors and people messing up the connection simply because it's all pre-assembled. Looking forward, we expect that these links will go to 400 gig, probably in the 2019-20 timeframe. We'll be looking at a slide coming up. There's a whole bunch of different proposals about exactly what that 400 gig technology will look like at various lengths and various fiber types. But we would expect this link simply to go up to that next speed as these switch silicons go up to that next speed, and roughly in that timeframe. Moving up to the next tier between the Tier 1 and the Tier 2, this changes a little bit, because while the distance that these cables had to do were either in the rack or inside the row, the distance between this row and where those IDFs are can be hundreds of meters. Matter of fact, it could be up to 2 kilometers on some of our campuses, because these IDFs may not even be in the same building as these servers in some of our campuses. So the length of these red lines is long, and this isn't just one little cable. Typically, out in the middle of this is some sort of trunk, because we don't run all of these individually. There's thousands of them, or even tens of thousands of them, so it's not like you would go to a row and run one and, you know, go a kilometer and then come back and run another one. You'd run a big trunk cable, and that trunk cable comes and terminates in this row, and the other end of it terminates back in the IDFs, and there's patch panels there, and you've got those connectors there. And the optic we use is pre-connectorized on one end, or connected to the optic on one end, and it has a connector on the other end that is an optical surface on there, and that optical surface mates into the patch panel. And indeed, we do have to clean and inspect that one end of that cable, but not two ends here. So this is, we call it a pigtailed one. It's one that actually we pushed the industry to develop. The underlying optical technology there is called PSM4, or parallel single mode 4. The fiber cable is actually 12 fibers, of which only 8 are used. There's 4 transmits at 25 gigs and 4 receives at 25 gigs inside of the actual cable, and the other 4 fibers are unused. The reason there's 12 fibers is because there is a 12 fiber connector standard. There was, at the time this was designed, not an 8 fiber connector standard, so some of the fibers go unused in this. So it does have a cleaning and inspection operation, but there's less of these than there are of these, so it isn't too tedious. And we get various lengths of those pigtails, and we can go up to 2 kilometers with this technology. Well, in general, we don't. When we install these clusters, they basically, inside of this cluster and the connections up to these tier twos are there for the life of this equipment, which is at least 3 years, maybe up to 5 years. So the basic mode of operation is you'll go build a cluster, you'll put all the servers there, the TORs, the tier one, you'll hook all that stuff up to the tier one, and those servers and that cluster will run 3 to 5 years intact. And when we upgrade it, we decommission the cluster. In fact, we might decommission the entire colo. There might be 10, 20,000 servers in there. We decommission them all at once. There's no way operation we can go on there and go 1 RU at a time. Yeah, I'm gonna upgrade the server today. just not gonna work at a scale standpoint. So we decommission entire rows or entire colos at a time. And that whole infrastructure comes out at once. The servers, the TORs, all of the optics. Because when we do that, if it's 3 or 5 years later, the technology is clearly going to change. So all of those optics, all those switches, all those servers, all those NICs are all end of life as far as we're concerned. And the technology may have even gone 2 generations if we waited 5 years. So none of that is useful from an infrastructure standpoint other than that trunk cable that was there. That single mode fiber trunk cable is a 15-year asset for us. It's a very expensive asset. So that actual physical fiber cabling that goes between all of the rooms and stuff costs a lot of money. And it's intended to be there for a really long time. But all the rest of that, we swap out as a generational type thing. We call it crop rotation. Plant it, grow it, harvest it, plant it, grow it, harvest it, yeah. If this data center is on a campus with another set of data centers, then there's another tier and in a set of hub locations that we call RNGs, or regional network gateways, which we'll talk about a little more here in a second. And the connection between those tier twos and those regional hub switches can also use that same PSM technology we were just looking at. If the cable plant that has been built between that data center and those hub sites exist at scale. In some places we are cable limited or conduit limited and we can't put in enough fiber to support that PSM. And there's another technology called CWDM4, even though it's a WDM technology, we still call it a gray link. And it uses 2 fibers and it uses a different technology to multiplex all 4 25 gig channels into 1 fiber one way and all 4 25 gig channels and the other fiber the other way. And it's a more costly module. It still goes 2 kilometers, but it only uses 2 fibers per 100 gig connection, whereas the other one was using 12 fibers per 100 gig connection. So we use smaller quantities of trunk cable in order to use this, but this is a more expensive optic. In fact, it's so much more expensive that the trunk cable's cheaper if we could put the trunk cable in, but in many cases, we're just conduit limited, and certainly going out and trenching and putting more conduit in is not something we'd want to do generally. So we use this in places where we're fiber count limited. Again, we would expect these links to go to 400 gig in the same time frame. So you see this theme of we were at the 40 gig ecosystem, we're now deploying the 100 gig ecosystem. 2019-20, there will probably be the 400 gig ecosystem. And each one of these links has got a particular technology being used, and we expect a 400 gig version of that to be evolving. In fact, we're driving a lot of that work in the IEEE standards. Back here is an eye chart. I don't expect you to be able to read this from the back, but this is from work that's going on inside of the IEEE committees. Brad Booth on my team and Tom Eisenhuth participate in this, as do a number of other people around the industry to drive all of these different technologies. We were pretty instrumental in establishing the 25 and 50 gig Ethernet standard in order to align with the SerDes speeds that were coming out from the current generation of chipsets. There's also a whole new series of lane speeds coming out that are built on 50 gig and even 100 gig, excuse me, lanes. Get a water here. And there's a committee for each one of these and a lot of debate going on for each one of these. And the color code there is simply which IEEE committee is working on that particular aspect of it. And in some cases, there hasn't been deemed a need to actually work on that particular aspect of it. The important part here for 400 gig, though, is that very last column. These are the current 400 gig E standards that are being proposed, everything from 100 meter type reaches to 500 to 2 kilometers to longer reaches, are being proposed for 400 gig. And if you go through the details there, you'll see the various lane speeds and the quantities of lanes that are required to solve that particular problem. Also, there's groups that are working on 200 gig E. Microsoft at this point doesn't really see a need for 200 gig E, but there are some people in the industry that are focused on that. And there will be modifications to 100 gig E to use these new lane speeds, which is the 100 gig E column that's coming up. And so it usually takes a year to 2 years to actually standardize this stuff in the IEEE committees before anybody actually builds the first parts in the industry. So there's a huge amount of effort to build these as standards because you need interoperability. I need to be able to plug one module on one switch and then somebody else's module on another switch and have them talk to each other over that piece of fiber and have that interoperability. Otherwise, we would have a really hard time building a network. Okay. So optics in the region. As I mentioned earlier, once we leave the data centers or leave a site, then we tend to use these DWDM technologies in order to put lots of capacity on fiber pairs and go around the region. This is an overview of our regional design. So if you take that previous data center, shrink it down, we can have lots of instances of those data centers in a region, dozens of them even. But we home all of those to a pair of hub sites, or four hub sites in some cases, and we call these hub sites regional network gateways. These regional network gateways have the next tier of what we call fabric switches in here, which are these blue boxes. And then above that, we have the pinkish boxes, which are part of our core and internet backbone. This is how the internet talks to us, and we send stuff back out to the internet. Very large scale boxes. They have very large buffers and very large forwarding tables in them. And then the green boxes are our internal data center to data center communication. They only have to contain our internal routing tables and our internal scale. So they're much smaller boxes in terms of fib table sizes and buffers and things of that nature. So they're much more cost effective. But traffic wise, they can carry as much or more traffic between our data centers than goes out to the internet. So gigabits or terabits per second wise, they're actually still quite large boxes, or we have lots of them. And then we use WDM technologies to leave this, and we use those gray optics things inside of the data center, or inside of these regional network gateways. So if I highlight the ones inside the regional network gateways there, all of the red lines there, we use that same AOC cable that we were using inside of the data center. We just connect these boxes together. They're all sitting there in rows next to each other, and we just patch between them. There can be thousands of connections inside there that use this AOC cable. And again, we'll see a 400 gig variation of that coming out. Once we leave the data center and we need to solve these metro type distances, nominally 80 kilometers or so, we must use some sort of DWDM technology in order to share these fibers and pack them with lots of different signals instead of burning a fiber pair or many fiber pairs per 100 gig signal. We pile a lot of stuff on there. This coming year, we are going to be deploying 100 gig technology. Internally, we call it Madison. It's a technology that Microsoft helped develop in partnership with a company named MFi. MFi calls the product Color Z, or Colors. It's basically, we've taken that QSFP28 form factor, and we've added some fancy modulation to it called PAM4 and some fancy FEC and other things to it. And it creates a 100 gig channel out of two wavelengths on a fiber, and then we can put up to 40 sets of those on a fiber and get 4 terabits per second on a single fiber pair and go up to 80 kilometers. And we use that in all of these red lines in order to build out capacity from data center to these gateway hubs and between the gateways themselves. Essentially, any place where we have sort of that 80 kilometer or less type reach and we're trying to pack the fiber, we'll target that technology. Now, there's other places where the fiber may be really expensive, or it may go further, or it's a really poor fiber. There's several other reasons we may want to use more advanced systems. So there's a whole technology called coherent, which originated in the long haul space but can be used in the metro. It lets us pack up to 19.2 terabits per second on a fiber pair with the current generation. It handles all kinds of different difficult use cases. However, it's 5 times more expensive than the Madison technology. Takes 20 times the power and 4 times the space. So it's a very powerful technology in terms of what it can solve problem-wise, but it's also very power-hungry and very costly to implement. So in general, if we can use the Madison technology, we will. But if Madison doesn't work in the particular use case, then we'll use the coherent technologies to interconnect these data centers over these metro links. Yes?
How much headroom do you see in the QAM side before that starts to really break down?
Yes, good question. I think it's the next slide. There it is. What a segue. So We clearly don't see that going beyond the 100 gig realm. So it was a point in time where it made sense to develop a technology to solve this at scale, mainly because the number of channels that we have in this environment are quite large. In fact, in some of our regions, there might be 10 to 20,000 100 gig links here. And so we needed something that was very cost effective at 100 gig to do that. We saw this problem coming, and we actually helped co-develop a solution for it. So at 400 gig, we looked at the market and said, yep, we still have the problem. We still want to provision maybe tens of thousands of 400 gig channels at some point in the future. Using the current coherent technology would be just as painful as it was before. What we need is a new coherent technology. And so we don't think it's the PAM technology. We think that there is a lightweight coherent version that can be built, something that doesn't go long haul or submarine type distances, but can solve this metro problem in a very small form factor and a very power efficient form factor. So our goal, and we're working with the suppliers and the development community right now, is to build a thing that we call coherent light. And it's optimized for metro 100 kilometer type reaches. We believe one of the possible solutions is a 64 QAM coherent modulation format running at 43 gigabaud. The big critical thing is we need that whole package, including the DSP and optics, to come in under 16 watts. If you look at our current things that just do 100 gigs, in the coherent space, it's 100 watts per 100 gig. So this is a power improvement, you know, roughly a factor of 30 better than the current coherent technology in order to solve this problem. And so
what is driving that requirement? Is it provisioning or dissipation of
heat? Yeah, it's this room. Yeah, so what happens is if I try to put 20,000 of these in this room becomes multiple megawatts of electrical consumption, just this room. Yeah, that we typically think of data centers as megawatts. When you start talking about your network room approaching a megawatt or 2 megawatts, we start getting concerned. And so the power consumption of those channels, when you start multiplying it by 10,000 or 20,000 or something like that, it goes up quite rapidly. And in fact, in this room, it dominates the power envelope if I were to use today's coherent. It's more power than all of the rest of the equipment in the room combined. And so it was why we developed Madison at 100 gig, and it's why we're saying at 400 gig we need some sort of lightweight coherent approach to solve the 400 gig speed and all of that. But we need it to fit in a power envelope. In fact, we're saying if it doesn't fit in this power envelope and cost envelope, we'll probably just stick with the 100 gig technology. This is what it takes to beat the 100 gig technology. Yeah, this capacity, based on the oversubscription numbers that we talked about earlier, is roughly 2% of the server-facing capacity in that data center.
It's still several thousand.
Hundreds of, it's over a petabit of capacity, yeah. So that tells you how much server-facing capacity.
And that's only 2% of what's inside one.
Yes, okay. Yeah. So a region here at this scale might have 1.5 million 50-gig servers. So 1.5 million times 50 gig, and you take 2% of that, and you get an idea of how big this cross-section might become if I were to build out a region at full scale.
This is why you're putting very big data centers all in the same place.
Well, I mean, in a metropolitan area, yeah. Sometimes these are campuses, and sometimes they're spread around. Okay. So the long haul and the submarine. Now we're going to, like, go extreme distances and try to solve things that go thousands of kilometers. We're talking about these links that leave out the top up here. So some of the work that Monia here did, along with some folks on my team, illustrated the value of what we call higher order modulation techniques and bandwidth variable transceivers. So instead of using the base coherent modulation scheme, which is called QPSK, quadrature phase shift keying, there are other more advanced modulation techniques that pack more points into a constellation. There's 8 QAM and 16 QAM, and there's other variations, but these are the common ones. And it allows us to pack more and more bandwidth into a certain spectrum inside of the fiber. And in fact, when you analyze our North American fiber routes, you'll see that by having these other modulation formats, just by going to 8 QAM, we can address almost all of the routes in our network. And if we go to 16 QAM, there's a certain set of routes we can address, but others are a little too long for that, and we still have to go to 8 QAM. But packing the network with higher order modulation allows us to get more bits through the fiber. And this is something that we're actually rolling out near the end of this year. And all of our new long-haul deployments will be based on these bandwidth variable transceivers and higher order modulation techniques. Across North America and eventually Europe as well. We're also implementing a thing called an open line system. So the line system is that set of equipment that lives out in the middle of the fiber as it goes between cities. About every 80 kilometers or so, there has to be an amplifier that boosts the signal back up, and then there's gain equalizers, and there's ROADMs and other pieces of equipment. It's basically everything but the endpoints that generate the optical signal and receive the optical signal, that is the sources or the transceivers. Everything out there in the middle is called a line system. Used to be that whole thing was just built by one supplier and managed and maintained by one supplier. We've actually separated it out so that the line system is separate, and we can buy the sources either and integrate them into the switches themselves, or we can have external pizza boxes, and these things are independent of each other, and we can buy best of breeds, whereas the line system is pretty static and it may live many, many years out in the field. The rest of these things change pretty rapidly. And so this open line system is actually under trial with us right now, and we are going to be deploying it at scale starting at the end of this calendar year and probably be in production early next calendar year. So what are the limits of this? How much stuff can you actually pack on fiber? So fiber is still an electromagnetic medium at the end of the day, photons are, and it's still Shannon's limit applies to fiber just as it does to RF signal. So ultimately, the amount of information you can pack in any particular media is limited by the bandwidth of the channel and the noise at the receiver, a la Shannon's formula there. So fiber has these limits. And the first thing that you notice if you look at the loss profile of fiber, there's a narrow optical window where the loss is low. So if you want to go large distances, you want low loss. And so almost all of the optical technologies you see that go any sort of distance are running in this part of the spectrum. Matter of fact, almost all the common ones run right here in the middle called the C-band. And all of the stuff we have deployed today is C-band. So that spectrum is limited simply by the physical characteristics of the fiber. Also, since you have to amplify this every 80 kilometers, so the amplifiers add noise, and the cascading amplifiers add cascading noise, and it accumulates as you go through more and more amplifiers. And you can't pump the power up anymore, because by cranking power up, you actually distort the optical signal, and there's a whole bunch of what we call nonlinear effects that kick in that distort the signal beyond recovery, so there's a limited amount of power you can put in. So all these things combine to paint you into Shannon's formula there that says, hey, you're only going to get so much bandwidth along that fiber. And if you go through the calculations and do some analysis and you look at a nominal 2,000 kilometer run, which wouldn't even get you partway across the United States, you can get about 30 terabits per second in one of these bands, like the C band or the L band. And so that kind of tells you 30 terabits, and I put another band on there, which is actually another set of amplifiers, so it's kind of like deploying a second line system. I can get 60 terabits then. I might do an S band one and get 90 terabits, but then that's it. That fiber pair is gone. There's nothing else theoretically I can do to it at that point. I'm breaking Shannon's law. And then the question is, well, what then? I filled up a fiber optically. One thing you can do is shorten the reach, and instead of going 2,000, go 1,000 or 500 and then regenerate it. That's expensive because I got to break all the channels out, recover it, and restart the whole thing all over again. But most likely what's going to happen is you start burning fiber pairs. You light up another fiber pair and another fiber pair. All right, well, there's only so many fiber pairs in the ground. So you're going to run out of that. In fact, I've worked at Level 3 back in the early days of my career and built a lot of the North American fiber plant. There's only so much of it there. We could put more in. It'd be expensive. The other thing is you could do some sort of new fiber type that like had multiple cores per fiber. There's some of that that's being proposed. Probably wouldn't see that till 2020 timeframe, 2021, something like that. But one of the ones proposed has seven cores in it, and the amplifiers amplify all seven cores simultaneously. And each one of those cores I can use over and over again. It's called spatial multiplexing. So I'm treating it like seven fibers that I've just welded together in a piece of glass. Now that would require new fiber being installed, but maybe that's the next generation of fiber. So the interesting point here is it's clear that we're actually coming up to the limits of what fiber can do. And it's running out of spectrum for us, and which a lot of people think of fiber as this unlimited resource, and it isn't. And we're not probably but a few years away from this. It's the end of my talk. I didn't see the red one.
Okay, thanks a lot, Jeff. I guess we have time for one question. Okay.
The idea is you would have an amplifier that was multi-core, so the amplifier would amplify all of the cores simultaneously. Yeah, that and just so from a physical line system standpoint, it would be one line system that supported seven cores versus seven separate line systems.
Atul?
Were you talking about my last slide, the optical power that's being launched into it, or were you talking about
the regional problem?
Yeah, yeah, okay. So, yeah, I know you and I have had a little bit of conversation around this before. So the I think it boils down to, well, you have to support the peak. so that facility would have to be able to handle all of the links up at some point in time. Otherwise, why would you have put the link in there to begin with? So the problem is building that facility to handle that 2 megawatts of power and the cooling load and associated with that. So you would have to decide what the peak was that you wanted to support. And the peak happens mostly under failure conditions, right? I've lost one of the gateways and all the traffic's going through the other gateway.
But it's quite possible the networking peak does not align with the compute peak or something like that, right?
I was just thinking of the network peak. Yeah, so whatever the peak network traffic is, we tend to design the network to support that under a failure condition.
Sure.
That is, if like one of the RNGs goes away, that last one has to support that much bandwidth. Well, that the one RNG did, but the second one has to take the whole load at that point.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks again. So our next speaker is Professor Ian White. So Ian is a professor at Cambridge, where he's also vice chancellor. And he got his PhD at Cambridge, and then he had faculty position at University of Bristol and Bath, and then he came back to Cambridge in 2001. So Ian has a tremendous research success. He has published almost, I think, 1,000 papers, ranging from topics like optoelectronic components, high data communication, as well as multimode fiber propagation. And today he's going to give us a different perspective on optics. So rather than focusing on long range, long haul communication, as Jeff Talk was focusing on, he's focusing on very short interconnect. In fact, he's focusing on board level optical interconnect.
Okay. Okay. Thank. thank you very much. Can I just start by saying what a great pleasure and privilege it is to be here? It's been the first time I've ever been at one of these meetings, and I've already found it fascinating. Listening to so many interesting presentations already today. The aim of this talk will really obviously to be build on meeting the continuing dramatic demands in the increase for bits that have risen so dramatically in recent years. And I will try and build on the talk that was given by the last speaker on the optical infrastructure being increasingly considered for use in possible data center applications, of which, we've heard so much earlier today, in terms of their increasing scale. My focus will mainly be, however, on some of the next generation optical technologies in the longer term that may potentially have relevance to the very short scale optical links, and possibly allow some functions currently used by electronic switching to be implemented optically. The last speakers commented extremely well on the relative merits of electronics and optics in data servers. There are certain areas where, as you said, electrical buses become increasingly difficult at very high frequencies or high bit rates. Their losses increase, their crosstalk increases. Various techniques need to be used in terms of signal processing to overcome that. And at that point, optical data transmission can be much easier. That really then has led in recent years to quite a lot of study, not solely about active optical links, which have already been described so well, but on whether actually there are optical technologies that one can start conceiving in the back plane and on the line cards to allow signals to communicate more easily, but also maybe in turn to implement optical functions. And therefore, in this talk, I'll really try and focus on these technologies. In doing so, may I stress, in advance of this session, I had contacted Karen Bergman, who's done outstanding work in optical switching, and asked her what the focus of her talk would be, were she to be able to, when she was due to attend. And she highlighted that she would be covering the use of integrated optical circuits for optical switching and routing. And indeed, that technology is very exciting and is one that I would have liked to highlight, particularly the way in which it's been able to be implemented, not solely in 3-5 semiconductors, but also in silicon semiconductors. But in seeking to take a complementary approach to her, I thought perhaps it would be worth just talking about some of the evolving interests in trying to build an element of optoelectronic processing on PCBs in it, rather than solely electronic. As has been highlighted early, optics is very effective for high-street communications, where electronics remains dominant for control of signals and in terms of its power dissipation. However, if some of the communications on board could be carried out, there's a real potential for reducing the onboard area for communications quite dramatically, by 60% or so, and driving up the interconnect density. And as a result, in recent years, many companies have studied the idea of implementing optical links on board. It's been an area for which there's been very great hope, but actually it's an area where there continue to remain very strong challenges. Because if you look at, and I quote this paper on purpose really to highlight how some of the challenges have proved to be easier than others. This is a relatively old paper back in 2010. Although the peak performance in terms of the number of channels, yes, it was predicted to grow from 2012 to 2010 by two orders of magnitude. The bit rates required were relatively modest. The power consumption that the transceivers would need to meet for onboard applications would have to fall significantly, but again, not too badly, from something like 25 milliwatts per gigabit on board down to, say, the order of a milliwatt per gigabit. However, the optics cost for real applications at that time was proposed to need to drop really quite dramatically. So from something like $1 per gigabit, which would have been not unreasonable for, actually relatively feasible for conventional transceivers, but down to something like 2 cents per gigabit, which of course is rather challenging. And therefore, in recent years, there's been a range of interests about how do you go about allowing optics to be embedded on the same board for data server type applications as electronics. There's been a lot of interest in embedding fibers straight into substrates. There's a lot of been interest on the back of a PCB putting a free space optic, some form of general slab waveguide, so that light can bounce from side to side. And then be transmitted and detected. Other groups, and we're one of these, has been very interested in these polymer materials, which you can spin straight onto a printed circuit board. You can indeed allow the polymer to flow over the printed circuit board so it can quite happily run over tracks. And the idea has been, can you develop this technology so it'll withstand solder overflow? And siloxane materials have been particularly of interest, though there are others. I'd like to recognize Dow Corning on this. The big advantage about these materials is they're polymer. You can just spin them on to the printed circuit board using very conventional technology. But they can withstand really rather high temperature, 350 degrees C. So literally having formed optical waveguides, you can drop electronic chips onto the board, you can solder them onto the board, and actually there's a lot of information now to indicate that the quality, the optical quality of the materials do not degrade very significantly and remain at attenuations of between, for example, in our case, 0.03 to 0.05 dBs per centimeter, which for on-plane applications is rather useful. In much of the work, although you can implement these guides in single-mode fiber, a particular interest has been to form them in multi-mode. And that is because if you're wanting to use these guides, and I'll talk about the components related to them, on real rack or server units, you don't want to have very tight tolerances. You want to be able to pull the board in, you want to pull it out, you don't want to care if it bends or if it gets distorted. And so if you can work to multi-mode waveguide sizes, so you say 50 microns per 50 microns, it means you can be sure that the tolerances cannot are relatively relaxed, i.e. plus or minus 10 microns really won't be a significant problem for the system. And that transforms the type of technology you need to use for connectorization, and indeed makes feasible the implementation of some of the circuits using pick and place machines. And it's been found that these waveguides then are the main question that arises is, are they able to operate at the speeds you want them to operate at? And it turns out that along with many groups around the world, it is found that actually they work relatively quickly. This is a standard 40 gigabit transmission over a 1 meter spiral waveguide made of the polymer on printed circuit board. The eye diagrams look fine, and indeed actually, despite the fact that this is a large multi-mode waveguide, with the order of a 30 by 30, you get similar results with 50 by 50. Notwithstanding that, they can meet the sort of data rate requirements. And indeed, actually, much more recent studies that have been carried out, the real indication are that 100 gigabits over these multi-mode fiber waveguides is really no problem, even allowing, pardon me, for very significant offsets that you may want in a real world where you might need to allow for 10 plus or minus 10 micron drifts. Now, the real vision behind this technology is not simply to be able to allow optics and electronics to coexist. It's basically to try and give new generations of companies control of this technology. For most of the time, in the last 20 or so years, if you've wanted to buy an optical unit, you've had to go off to a module manufacturer, and you buy the module, often within a special form factor, and you put it on a printed circuit board. Now, one of the huge advantages about optics is that that has allowed huge increases in performance, great reductions in cost. There'll be some areas like active optical cables where the installation means that it's requirement. The downside, however, is that it means that optics have never matched the success of electronics, where in electronics you can use a relatively small number of integrated circuits and then put them on a printed circuit board and lay the wiring out as you would want. And if it was possible to have an optical equivalent of the electrical printed circuit where you can start to do these things, then of course it means that other players can come in, can design bespoke circuits, and you can start doing new things. And as a result, there's been a lot of emphasis placed on how do you take these circuits and use them to, say, have different functions. So allow waveguides to cross each other, 90-degree crossings, S-bends, 90-degree bends, splitters, and the like. And it has been encouraging in recent years to see this developing, and I'll show examples later. Also, of course, there's been a lot of emphasis on how to couple light into the waveguides, because that has to be very cheap. The two basic techniques of out-of-plane coupling, where, say, you put your transceiver, your laser, your LED, your detector on the top, and you shine the light down and into the waveguide, or say light comes out and falls in a photodiode. There's been a lot of different implementations we'll show in a minute. The other way is simply to take a plug and place machine, drop the unit into a via, and shine the light right in. And that is also frequently used. And these are a range of examples. End fire, dropping down works very effectively, but people have looked at optical rods to take light from surface amounts and then off a reflector into the waveguide. They've done integrated reflectors, ball lenses to assist the coupling, and fiber connections as well. We've, just to highlight, tried to do very basic designs, trying where possible to use standard electronic equipment that you would be able to implement in optical electronic workshops. So take, say, an FR board, spin on the polymer layers, cut holes in them, simply just drop units basically in, say a VCSEL, so it shines the light straight in, a photodiode detects light at the other side, and then say put connectors on so that your output tracks onto different circuits. And sorry about the lag here. But basically this technology seems to be really quite practical. So this is a very standard 10 gigabit transceiver laid out straight on the circuit board. A plick and place machine is used to literally just drop waveguide and photodiode straight into the circuit board there. Underneath in the polymer layers, we have a Y splitter and a combiner so that the laser diode light comes down this track through the splitter and out. Any signal coming down this in a bidirectional link can be split and go to the photodiode. There's the light picked up by a digital IR camera where the signals come through the splitter and along to the edge there, running quite happily at 10 gigabits. Nothing special in terms of speed, but it just highlights the flexibility. The aim, however, in this work is not simply to try and replicate. The aim is to say, are there ways in which some functions beyond simple point-to-point links can be implemented? Because they might give extra degrees of freedom in rack design and indeed switching design. So a lot of interest in recent years has gone on in backplanes, where optical single point-to-point links are used to take, say, a signal off a board, send it down a link along a backplane and onto another board. And there's been a wide range of interest in these fields. However, we've been quite interested to see to what extent actually the optics can be used to facilitate routing. Because as was highlighted in the last talk, these days it's quite easy to buy very low-cost transceiver arrays, arrays of, say, lasers or arrays of receivers. And of course, in the main, as is described in the last talk, they're used to allow very high bit rates to be transmitted, say, along ribbon fibers, from point to point. But actually, there's no reason why you couldn't implement a very basic shuffle router system, say, where every board has an array of these transmitters and an array of receivers. And you basically just use a shuffle routing network implemented on your plastic so that if you want to connect from board one to board two, you simply light up this laser and it's detected on this detector, 1 to 3 and 1 to 4. Now, one of the things that surprised us when we started working on this technology for this board, we started off in the first design by saying, let's just have a simple ribbon fiber from our board onto the backplane, but obviously you could implement full connect backplane connectors for it. Was that if you started needing to make circuits of this sort of sophistication, we worried whether we'd really get hit by crosstalk. Because actually, obviously, in many switches, the ultimate limit of performance is not the switching time or the loss, but actually it's the crosstalk. Because if you've got a very large array switch, and you've got a lot of crosstalk, you can forget about seeing anything either in any state. And so in this situation, you see, you're having, say, blade one, transmitting light onto four channels. If you want to do a loop back, transmitter one is turned on and the signal comes back to receiver one. If you want to go to card two, you light up this line and it goes through there, three there and four there. And one of the things that we find very interesting is that actually, if we were to compare implementing this sort of network on a large piece of plastic, suitable sort of backplane size, because that's the space you've got available, the crosstalk actually is far smaller than it would have been if it was in an integrated circuit chip this size, which surprised us at the time, but thinking about it, it's rather obvious. And so actually, this is what we call our terabit shuffle router. So we've got 10 blades being served. So five transmitters come in here, five transmitters come in there. The receiver patch boards come in here or here. And basically, every interconnection is possible by simply lighting up a different laser or VCSEL. Some of the links are very short, so the fold line back link here from this transmitter to there is very straight. But some are actually really rather long. So if I want to go from this transmitter down to that one, the link actually crosses 100 waveguides to get from one end to the other. And the thing that surprised us was that if we had a restricted launch coming in, we only had 4 dB loss even after all those crosstalks. And even in that scenario, with a multi-mode fiber launch, had a worst case crosstalk of 35 dB optical, which is 70 dB, remember, electrical. So basically, you've built a very basic, simple switch. And we call this terabit because each of these lasers are running at 10 gigabits. We've got 10 of them, so that's 100. And then, of course, per blade, and we've got 10 blades, hence a terabit. Simply by just using a bunch of VCSEL arrays and a piece of plastic and a bunch of, sorry. Well, it's up to, normally, it varies a lot. And it's a very good question in one sense, because going forward, you should simply turn it completely off. Normally, most current transceivers will leave it in an ambient state, but there's no need for this sort of application to do that. There is, that's why currently most communication receivers would require that. But if you're basically working on packet switching times and power dissipation is a much bigger issue, then the latest generation of lasers, you should be able to get away with it fine. If it's on the basis of a packet burst where you're literally being able to allow a nanosecond or so guard time, you can get away with dramatically reducing the power consumption, if that's a big deal.
Why is the insertion loss larger for the multi-mode fiber?
Why? Because basically it's the bends, okay, essentially. And also, these are 50 micron guides. So when they go through a crossing, in a multi-mode launch, you've got more higher order modes, which are near the edge. So you get slightly more scattering, which is also why the crosstalk's worse than this. But you know, considering that, you know, this is crosstalk after 100 crosses, you know, it's not unreasonable. And obviously, there's nothing scalable about this. And I'm going to jump ahead in the talk, but I do want to make the point that one of the attractions of this technology for this level is that there's nothing stopping you making multiple levels of this, like multi-level PCBs, and actually having different interconnect patterns on the different PCB levels. Okay, so you could go far higher than what we've done here. we also, of course, are interested in buses. Regenerative buses are nasty for optics at the moment. So basically, I'll just very quickly talk about how we've essentially implemented the equivalent of a regenerative bus with 3R receivers. The problem with buses and optics is you have to tap power out, and there's nothing you can get around that. You lose photons every time you tap power out, and if you do the calculations, basically, the relatively few number of boards you have to go. So this is, again, shows the sort of circuit. Here is four channels of a bus, four bus lines. You could obviously increase these, but we've stopped this to show the functionality. We want to tap a signal out This gets tapped out, the rest goes through. That's tapped out, the rest goes through. Adding signals onto the bus line, you simply fire in from that side, add, fire in from this side, and add. And these circuits are very easy to make. We're just using colored lights here to light up the guides to show you the fact that these things do work. But as a technology, it's a very, very simple technology we can simply lay out. And indeed, actually, we've done quite a lot of demonstrations on this. reliability and uniformity is a major challenge. But actually, so far, this technology surprised us. This is the power budget for the 10 gigabit system. All the lines are well below. There are changes, but those changes are not due to manufacturing. They're due to the fact that, obviously, if you've got a bus which has already dropped a lot of signal, say at this point you're going to see a much higher loss than the output coming out here because it's had to go through more splitters. So basically most of the loss, and actually you can, even using basic university technologies, where I have to say our university is not among the most robust manufacturing technology by any means, it's actually within a few dBs, which is fine, and those are the eye diagrams of the system. I just want to say a few words about the future. I touched on this, but this technology has attracted a lot of interest in recent years in the fact that it is very suitable for making multi-level systems and actually making multi-level functional objects. And it's also suitable for making flexible. So there's nothing really stopping this technology being used in a fully flexible format, even with splitters. And we've done quite a lot of work on that, studying the impact of radius on it. One of the attractions we've got for the multi-level is that we seriously think also that it's a way of starting to look at really high bit rates. Using these 2D array systems, we start now talking more about, rather than just terabit per link, we start working in units of terabit per square millimeter. So if you take a square millimeter of end of the waveguide, and you're going to shine light in it, how many terabits can you do per square millimeter of that? And actually, for this technology, and we've done quite a lot of work, provided it's not hugely long links in our thing, you'd want to link it into proper fibers at a later point. Actually, really using even LEDs, let alone lasers, which is a goal for us with this technology, you can literally be talking about terabits per square millimeter relatively effectively. One of the reasons we keep talking about LEDs every now and again is that one of the great visions of this work is to end up using plastic LEDs and plastic detectors, so that you could inkjet print everything on the printed circuit board, detectors, LEDs and waveguides. And that then makes the cost a very different proposition from having to use discrete components. I think plastic lasers are some distance away. The final thing is I would like to highlight is that we do think there's a lot of interest in WDM. Sorry, I don't know quite why this is not. Okay. And therefore, the use of multiple colors. And this, I'm just going to show this to give you a vision of why we like this technology. This is a one way, there would be others to do this, to implement WDM actually on this plastic technology. So visualize this area here as being, you know, part of your PCB. And if you think about it, you can think of it as a two-dimensional optical table, okay? You squeeze the light vertically, it has to go in the plane. But actually, sometimes it's nice not to have it in a waveguide. So what we do in this is we have waveguides initially, so that's where they're running here. But after an end, we stop the waveguides, and we just allow the light to diffract out, okay? And then what we say is fine. If the light is diffracting out like this, let it hit a mirror. And that's literally just a hole we've punched.
And that, space?
Yeah, so it's as if it's in free space, but you've squeezed it, so it's not allowed to go vertically. It only can go horizontally. And of course, if this is a concave mirror, that forms a parallel beam. And what we then say is, okay, let's punch these little triangles. And at that point, it's like a parallel beam hitting a diffraction grating. And so the wavelengths start coming off in different directions, and you punch another concave mirror, which focuses the light down, and hopefully, depending on what the wavelength is, the light comes out. And even for relatively modest launch conditions, these are sort of multi-mode type conditions, you can get certainly wavelength separations comparable to coarse WDM or low-coarse WDM and get very simple separation. So what we are just interested in is this as being a technology which might have potential benefits for certain types of data server application where you would want some form of functionality, where you'd want to have flexibility of being control, and also does give you the scope for getting to high bit rates. But I have to say that on the basis that there's also excellent silicon photonics technologies and other technologies as well. Thank you very much.
Okay, just very quick because we are out of time. Yeah.
Right, so, you know, within a rack, right, you have small volume and massive temperature variation, right? On a single blade, across blades, and so forth. How much of a concern is wavelength drift as a function of temperature?
So for the WDM systems I've shown here. That wouldn't be a problem for the channel separations I was showing. For the DWDM that was referred to, it's a completely different story. If it's a few nanometers, you should be absolutely fine. I have to say there are a number of technologies starting to come along looking hard at uncooled solutions to the DWDM problem. Actually, you can do a huge amount with signal processing, which removes the wavelength registration issue. But for this sort of application, no, it should be okay. And normally these components, there's a requirement to be able to use them at very high temperatures anyway. That's the nature of the cheap components. We're really just leveraging what's going on.
Okay, thanks, Ian. In the interest of time, I think we should take the other question offline. So we now move to the last speaker of our session. So Professor Ming Wu from University of California, Berkeley. So Ming got his PhD in Berkeley, and then he was a research staff at AT&T, and then he also held a professorship at UCLA, and then he moved back to Berkeley, too many universities, where he's also the director of the sensor and actuator group. So also Ming is a top researcher in the area. He has published many papers, again, in multiple fields, including nanophotonics and optofluidics and MEMS. And today he's going to talk to us about his recent piece of work about how to build a fast optical switch. Thanks a lot, Ming.
Thank you for the introduction. I struggled last night trying to convert my normal slide to this white format. I saw Microsoft must have artificial intelligence did much faster conversion than I can. So appreciate that. So it's a pleasure to be here to talk about our work on silicon photonic switches. And in the next 15 minutes or so, I'll talk about a little bit introduction. I think Jeff has covered that very well, that there is facing a challenge in data centers for the interconnection network, and photonic switches has been proposed as one possible solution. And we look at what switches are available right now, what are likely to become available at low cost, high volume in the next few years. And we believe one of our switches is one possible candidate. Actually, Ian's group has done wonderful work on semiconductor optical amplifier type of switch. I thought you would talk about that. So I have not included any active type of switches. These are purely passive switches. So As Jeff mentioned, with the shifting traffic in data centers, with so-called east-west traffic now dominance, and with server rate increasing rapidly, this plays a lot of strain on these so-called merchant silicon switches. And they are scaling with Moore's law, but with increasing port count for scaling out of the data centers and scaling up of the bit rate, they are facing serious challenges. George Pappen, which is our colleague in Cyan, NSF Research Centers, told me that there's probably another two generations for the switches to scale. So a lot of researchers has been turning to optical switches to alleviate and potentially augment and help scaling up the data centers in various ways. Potentially, they can reduce the number of hops. Potentially, if they have low enough loss, they can reduce the number of transceivers, which we just learned is a big cost of the data centers, and certainly power consumptions. Karen Bergman, who presented the wonderful talk at OECC last week, has pointed out these critical parameters we have to look into. Not all optical switches are the same. The switching time, the time it takes for the system to administer their connections, and optical switches being fundamentally optical circuit switches rather than packet switches. They need to be scheduled. Cost, power consumption, scalability are all important issues to look into. In the past several years, being part of this NSF Cyan Engineering Research Center, which is several members are here, George Pappen, Dan Kilper, Madeline are here. So at the UC San Diego, they've been looking at the so-called hybrid data center networks using optical circuit switch the network to augment the standard electrical packet switch networks. And they have come up with this interface they call reactor, very cleverly allocating traffic. The longer flow traffic will go through these 100 gigabit per second optical circuit switch network, whereas the smaller chunks of data will flow through the lower cost 10G electrical packet switching networks. And this will accommodate link rate from the host with 100 gigabit per second. The optical circuit network offers very high bandwidth. They are, of course, without buffer. And so they schedule the network to work in a time division multiple access manner. The transmitter transmits only when the circuit connects. Electrical packet switching, on the other hand, they have low bandwidth, but they handle small packets and they buffer all the way and they can transmit all the time. What they are finding is rather interesting is, well, they utilize these commercial off-the-shelf switch from Nistica, which is about 10 microsecond or so switching time. So they use 30 microsecond as a reconfiguration time and roughly about 10 times connection time. And what they found is by combining these 10G electronic packet switching and this faster rate 100G optical circuit switch, the performance is roughly equal to that of 100G electronic packet switches. Well, George is here, so certainly if there are more questions, I'm sure he can address those. There are many proposals, so these are only examples how optical circuit can potentially be used, and certainly Microsoft have your own version of it. This is another one that was reported in last week's conference. So this is work from Ed Osella from UC Santa Barbara, where they have inserted a layer of optical switches in between the usual spine and leaf architectures. And these switches here, they use a wavelength domain switches. It can, in principle, be space domain switches as well. But they have proposed very compact version of optical wavelength selective switches that at every node, they can selectively drop any number of wavelengths through this input and output node. And this will dramatically scale out the data center and accommodate the high throughput traffic. The difference between wavelengths and space domain switching, obviously, when you go to the wavelength domain switching, then the whole data center needs to migrate over to possibly tunable transmitter and receivers. These are obviously a very big change for data center and potentially expensive proposition. So next, I will look at what switches are currently commercially available. Certainly, there are a lot more switches that have been reported in the literature. But currently, Calian has been shipping switches with 320 by 320 ports. Polatis just announced a slightly higher port count. These are all free space-based switches, so they consist of either MEMS mirrors that's steering the light, or piezoelectric actuators, again, steering light. Their common attributes, they all have high port counts. They can probably be scaled up even further. And we're maintaining very low insertion loss, allowing potentially the switches to be inserted without impacting the link budget. They are relatively slow, 10 to 25 milliseconds. So they're generally more suited for video streaming or other steady traffic patterns, or even patch panels just to reconfigure the data center networks to accommodate different applications, say in a multi-tenant type of data centers. They also have high cost because it does take a lot of manual assembly to make the switches. The other switch, integrated switch, also often called 2D switches because they are integrated in a plane. Currently, 16 by 16 is commercially available from NTT Electronics or NEL. They have also published 32 by 32 switches. Potentially, these are integrated photonics technology, can be made at very low cost and faster response time. Their loss currently higher. The port count is limited. Now, if we look at sort of the fundamental scaling of 2D versus 3D, this argument has been made in the past decade also, why these 3D switches are more scalable than 2D switches, because they only require 2N active elements. The elements here are basically steering mirrors, whereas 2D switches, in general, you need n square switching elements. The exact number depends on the switch architecture, but let's take roughly this n square switching law. So to, for example, scale to 1,000 by 1,000 port count, you will need roughly a million switching elements. Now, that used to be a scary number for integrated photonics community. Now comes along silicon photonics, where in electronics community, we now routinely integrate billions of transistors without even questioning whether that's a high cost proposition or not. So this could potentially be a game changer to change, to tick the balance if the number and complexity is the only bottleneck. We could achieve much higher integration density compared with the previous 32 by 32 2D switches, which is made in glass waveguide. The waveguide dimensions are 5 micron by 5 micron. In silicon photonics, the waveguide dimensions are roughly 500 times smaller. So the integration density is about 500 times higher. So you could potentially integrate a lot, much larger number of components in the same area. As a further example, this switch, 32 by 32, occupies an area roughly 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter. So it's hard to get any chip that are larger than that. Now, many companies and research institutes are working on this newer silicon photonics technology. I highlighted here an example from AIST, which is a Japanese national lab. They have demonstrated a 32 by 32 switch using this matrix shown above. This schematic is for 8x8. The photograph here is for 32x32. And if you compare with the area, it's roughly about 1 centimeter by 2 centimeter. So about 100 times smaller than the previous PLC technology. This sort of illustrates the potential of silicon photonics in high density, high port count switches. These switches utilize heaters and utilize a cascaded 2x2 switches. This is because in photonics, that's the only switching elements available. So one drawback of this technology is high insertion loss. The insertion loss here, we're counting only on-chip loss, is roughly 16 dB for 32x32 switches. 32x32 switches go through 32 stages of this 2x2. So roughly, each stage gives you half a dB loss, which is pretty good. But unfortunately, as you scale up, you add up those losses, which become quite substantial. So we've been thinking, how can we break this fundamental limit? How can we take advantage of this high integration density without suffering the penalty of these cumulative losses? So again, here shows you this example of 8x8 and roughly 0.5 times port count dB for the total insertion loss. So our idea is shown on the right here. Now, if you don't have this active cross point, if you have a passive cross point, there are literally no loss. We have designed and actually experimentally measured. If we just have a crossing waveguide, we can have loss as low as 0.01 dB. So literally, you can have hundreds of them, and they still have very little impact on the total switching loss. Now, this is encouraging. Ultimately, we still need something that switches light. So what we have here is we introduce a switching element that directs light only when it is needed. And they literally disappear when we don't want them. For example, when light is just passing through the straight sections, we don't want them to see the switching element because they introduce crosstalk, they introduce residual losses. This was not possible with the standard electro-optic switching or thermal optic switching that are commonly available in silicon photonics. By using, however, the MEMS technology that we physically move the waveguides, we can literally make them disappear when we don't need them. With that, we are able to demonstrate switches that are 64x64, which to our knowledge, this is the largest 2D switch, with only 4 dB on-chip loss. And this is made in our university fab. As Ian mentioned, we certainly, our fab is not comparable to TSMC's foundry. So here gives you a little bit more detail how we implement that active switching element. You can sort of see from this animation, at the bottom, you see these crisscrossing waveguides. There's some spatial design at the crossing point to make the crossing low loss. To switch, we have these second layer waveguides. They are made of also silicon, and they are tapered in such a way we call adiabatic coupler. And to switch, we use MEMS actuators to lower down these waveguides. And when they are in close proximity, by close proximity, I mean 100 nanometer apart, 100% of the light will go through the upper waveguide and turn, make a 90 degrees turn, land in these vertical waveguides. And theoretical simulation shows that the insertion loss, if there's no material loss, they are roughly about 0.02 dB, actually very, very low. And when these waveguides are 1 micron apart, the interference is less than minus 60 dB. So if we compare the scaling of this switch, we call passive metric switch, with other architecture, the previous architecture, for example, they call PILOS, and we see that when you scale out to 100 port, this is literally the only option that can give you low loss. We have made a switch in our clean room, university clean room, 64 by 64 switch fits comfortably in a 1 by 1 centimeter die. Each switching cell is about 100 micron by 100 micron. This is the scanning electron micrograph. This is the solid work visualization. Lower waveguide is in red and upper waveguide is in blue. And actuation is by voltage. And this summarizes the switch performance here. First of all, it's a digital switching due to the fundamental nature of these MEMS actuators. When we move down the actuator, after actuation, they turn on and they stay on. The loss will not change with voltage. And there's a hysteresis loop that allow you to hold the state in on or off states. Now, they are much smaller than the traditional 3D MEMS switch. The response time can be made much faster, some microseconds. So now it's actually attractive for data center type of applications. And in terms of loss, indeed, compared with the cascaded 2x2s, they would be 1,000 times lower loss if they were able to continue scaling. Last point, these switches are capacitive load. They're literally like CMOS. They don't consume power if you don't change state. If you change state, it consumes only about 10 picojoule per changing state. Now, this is not 10 picojoule per bit. 10 picojoule is for the entire duration of hundreds of gigabits. So that's literally negligible if you measure in per bit. It is broadband, so it works for 1.3, 1.5. You have to design 1.3 or 1.5, but it's broadband. It's compatible with CWDM if we move to CWDM, for example. We have done preliminary collaboration on packaging with Tyndall Institute. And with this package, the switch actually goes to George Pappen's lab in UC San Diego, and they are able to flow light traffic through the two ports, and showing that here is a switching window of about 600 nanoseconds, and the data are nicely recovered. So let me summarize. I think silicon photonics is a very attractive approach for space division switches, potentially for data center applications. Our early first prototype, we are able to do 64 by 64 with on-chip loss of 3.7 dB with some microsecond switching time. I'd like to point out there is plenty of room for scaling with these switches. I can see it goes to multiple hundred by multiple hundred ports with a loss number even lower than this 0.05 dB to port count ratios. So lastly, I'll just thank the postdocs and students who done the work, and Tyndall Group for doing the packaging, George Pappen's group for doing the system testbed measurement, and our sponsor at NSF and DARPA. Thank you for your attention.
Hey, thanks a lot. Question?
Yeah, so being MEMS, they sort of have, I take out the slide. So actually, they are really reliable. So a good analogy is probably this projector. If it uses Texas Instruments digital micromirrors, they have similar resonance frequency. Resonance frequency is relatively high, about 100 kilohertz, multiple 100 kilohertz. Compared with the larger 3D MEMS, their resonance frequency is hundreds of hertz. That's the dangerous regimes where it's very sensitive to vibrations and bumping. At hundreds of kilohertz, it literally do not sense any vibrations. The spring is very stiff. In our lab, we have done reliability cycling without packaging in ambient, which is the worst conditions, we cycle over 10 billion times without seeing any adverse effect. We have also keep the switch in the on state continuously for 48 hours, and they do not change the switch characteristics. So with packaging, it's only going to get better.
Okay, Jeff.
Where did the 3 or 4 dB of insertion loss come from?
Ah, very good question. So I only counted the on-chip loss because we haven't worked on the coupling yet. So currently, the loss come from the crossing. It come from the waveguide loss. It come from the switching. So when it goes to the upper waveguide, we use a slightly higher lossy material. It's polysilicon. Roughly, that coupler loss is about a dB. So that can be drastically reduced. The other losses are roughly dominated by silicon waveguide propagation loss. Our current waveguide loss is about 1 dB per centimeter. State of the art, if you go to the best foundries, best fabrication, is probably about 0.2 dB per centimeter. So there's a five times room there to go. So I would anticipate we'll be able to scale out to several hundred port, maintaining ultimately, hopefully, the total fiber-to-fiber loss on the order of perhaps 4 dB, allowing 1 dB for each coupling, 2 dB for on-chip propagation.
I think we'd want to get the goal even lower because, it's a challenge. The challenge we've seen kind of historically in trying to use in any form of switching like this in a data center is the cost of the optics.
Right, right.
And if we have to go up to the next step of optics that has a higher dB margin, it obliterates any sort of switching cost. The optics cost more than the switch.
Mm-hmm.
So the cheap optics tend to have an overall margin of 4 dB.
Mm-hmm.
and so if I've got a patch panel and another patch panel and this in the middle of it, we're already over the margin of the cheap optics.
Right, right, right. So I understand that transceivers, you're pushing sort of the link budget to probably less fraction of a dB. If there is a way to increase that link margin by 2 dB, then you know a lot of these options will be kind of interesting.
Those transceivers cost twice as much as the 4
dB. Right, 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 right.
So that's what's killing you kind of at the moment is
to
get a 6 dB margin transceiver at the
same
cost as
So yeah, that's true. As a kind of direct plugging without any change of the current infrastructure, that's obviously the most desirable solutions. And I think there is a path that we need to work very hard on the packaging part. There's a path towards 2 dB insertion loss. 4 dB certainly is more comfortable.
Sure. And we've seen that generation after generation in transceivers.
Yeah.
That is something that's a 4 dB margin transceiver.
Right.
About half the cost of something that's a 6 dB. And it stays true over time, and it stays true from generation.
That's true. I also discussed extensively with a friend of mine in the transceiver business, and he said, well, it's really, this is the spec, and people don't design over the spec, and there's no reason to offer better than the spec, and they still won't be able to charge you more. So when there is a scenario of 2 dB, we're certainly not limited by any physical fundamental physics limit.
Ratul asks.
So I'm just kind of wondering about the 1 microsecond switching time. Is this uncomfortable regime, right? Because it's not really packet level switching.
Mm-hmm.
So what that basically means, I still need scheduling algorithms on top and some scheduler on top. So that kind of makes me wonder, like, why do 1 microsecond? Can I get something in return if I've made it 10 microseconds? Given that I need all this optical complexity on top to fit this into my data center anyway. If you had given me nanoseconds,
Right. So I had prepared this chart. These are sort of fast silicon photonic switches. Unfortunately, they have to employ these lossier mechanisms. So now you have a fast switch, but you may not be able to use it because of the loss. Now, obviously, this corner, high port count nanosecond switch, is sort of the most desirable corner. But we are limited by various physical mechanisms. For the MEMS, I think if you really push it hard, you may be able to reduce that by a factor of 5, I'm guessing, 100 nanoseconds may be feasible. But maybe George can comment on these time scheduling algorithms. It does takes time for control plane to figure out what is the best configuration for the next connection.
Let's just say that the relationship between the physical switching time and the speed at which the control plane can operate is an open research question. It's very difficult because it depends on the number of servers, if you know things about the traffic, how you collect the traffic statistics. These are not easy questions to simplify into one sentence. But the statement of building a reactive control plane in a microsecond being difficult is absolutely true, particularly at the scale that Microsoft is interested in building data centers. That is true. That will be a very, very good
The speed of light diameter of the network's much larger than that.
Right.
just
collecting the data from the number, in other words, trying to come up with an intelligent decision at that time scale is
okay, one last question.
Ben? Just a comment really on the sort of the cost of transceivers when you're doing a comparison with what you have today with what this would enable you. I think we need to remember as well that the idea of this is Cintas at the moment. What you have is you have a transceiver on your operator switch, wherever it might be. You have another transceiver on the electrical switch as well. You then have, let's just assume you've got one layer of electrical switching. You've then got another two transceivers to get back to your other server. And what we're really saying with something like this is you do away with two of the transceivers. So the two transceivers, yes, you go from 4 to 2, essentially.
Right.
Well, more than that.
So I think the topology you would use then would be another open question.
Yeah.
To me, I'm not sure that I could just replace it here and get the same functionality out of the network. But we've looked at, do I insert it? Do I replace it? A tier, and we looked at all of the permutations of that. It's not quite clear which one's the winner. Guessing in every case, even if I replace it, the cost of the transceivers outweigh the cost of the switch I replaced plus that. Now, if I get 6 dB transceivers at the same cost as I'm getting 4 dB transceivers today, I get this down to like 2 dB, then it all kind of comes together because the diameter of these data centers are large, right? I pointed out some of those cables are 2 kilometers long.
Yeah.
So I'm eating dB and cable
mm-hmm.
and patch panels, and I want to put the switch in the middle of it. And it's the cumulative effect of all of that. So,
mm-hmm.
So if I were to do what you suggested, for example, and replace a tier 2 switch, I might go through 4 kilometers of cable plus 4 patch panels, and I need an optic that can do that whole thing. Yeah. So that dB margin really becomes critical. So some of it could be on the transceiver mm-hmm. side, we boost it. Some of it, we get the switch margin better,
mm-hmm.
And then maybe somewhere in the middle it could be.
Can the patch panel and the switch be combined into one?
Question of the patch panel is just mm. terminating a trunk, right?
Mm.
So what would happen in that 2 kilometer link is this big trunk cable shows up.
Yeah.
Now I would have to like fusion splice it all in or something. So it could be operationally difficult to install it under those conditions. Not saying impossible.
Okay, so I think it's a good time to end the session. So thanks a lot again to Ming and to all the speakers. And thank you all for attending.